This may even become an escape from the works of charity we really can do to those we know. God may call any one of us to respond to some faraway problem or support those who have been so called. But we are finite, and he will not call us everywhere or to support every worthy cause. And real needs are not far from us.
So that was one like I liked, but I also gave you a weird feeling to it. So,
yeah.
So we're going to explore some of this later. This one I liked, even just kind of straightforward, from Martin Luther King, Dr. Jr. It may well be that we will have to repent in this generation, not merely for the vitriolic words and the violent actions of the bad people, but for the appalling silence and indifference of the good people who sit around and say, wait on time. I would have finished and been ready to present to you my comprehensive Save the World plan with PDF files on a thumb drive and packets for old-fashioned types. But then sometime about Thursday, I realized that I was about 3 PhDs short of my comprehensive Save the World plan. So I don't have that prepared for you today, but I do have a sermon on priorities. And for me, the impetus for this sermon, largely, it comes, I think, both because in our own lives, just our, you know, the ordinary nitty-gritty lives, it can be difficult to get our priorities straight. Has anybody ever spent 5 years, every year, trying to read, oh, this year, I'm going to list it all out, I'm going to do the to-do lists, and get, oh, maybe I'll go electronic this time, and reminder note, and there's all this, and we constantly, most of us, have to redo it. There are a few strange souls in the world who just naturally make a list, get it done, go on to the next thing. But I think for many of us, having some extra tools in that can be really useful. But there's this whole other issue of like the save the world issue. And I think that if you find yourself at a UU fellowship on a Sunday morning, you've probably got some degree of the save the world thing going on in your mind. Or at least if you don't want to be that messianic, right, you've got a help the world thing going on, right? Would anyone say that you come here partially because you've got this help the world plan, like, come on, like let's get it together, right? Otherwise, you know, you could be at home listening to, they don't have car talk anymore, but you could be listening to something on the radio, like eating scones that you fresh baked, like, come on, it's daylight savings time, and yet, you made it here, right? Because I think there's something about this getting together to try to make a positive change. But that is also slightly stressful, would you not agree? Has anyone ever felt stressed out about the Save the World plan? Right? Okay, well, we better get to work on this. So, in contemplating what's talked about this morning, I just sort of sat down and did a little brain drain, and I came up with five big reasons for me of why that feels so darn stressful, or sort of five questions that can be really helpful. So this is my short list. It's not exhaustive or edited in any way. This is my raw contemplation process. So I thought we needed to know really how to deal with the fact that there's just so much to do, right? These are my three, which three PhDs did I decide I needed? I needed a poli-sci PhD, I wanted an environmental science PhD, and economics. These were the three that I thought, and then I figured the mathematics that went with that and the science that went with that would give me, you know, enough of, and then my own leadership and communication and psychology studies, I figured I'd be set after that. Anyway, but geez, that's a lot to do. Okay, how to deal with either or decisions, and we're going to get into that in a minute, but this is where you've got like two right choices, but you've only got the resources to do one of them, and you have to like make these executive Game of Thrones decisions of who lives and who dies in the decision-making realm, right? No fun. Okay, and then just generally, how do you deal with the stress of it all, right? What kind of positive psychology things have you got for me, Reverend Faju, about why does this feel so stressful? How to deal with not being able to do it all, Right? Same flavor, but slightly different, right? This thought for me comes up of like, it's not exactly the either-or decision, it's just, well, I have some of the resources, but there's just, I'm not going to be able personally to do it all, and it kind of hurts a little bit. And then how to deal with the existential dread. Maybe that doesn't mean anything to you yet. A couple of you are like, oh, good, he went there. But that's one, a big one for me, so I'll describe it to you later. So these are my five. You may have more to add to this list, and we'll see where we go. But we're going to get into it right now. So I want to start with number two, how to deal with either-or decisions. So the real inspiration for this sermon came from a member of our congregation who will remain nameless for their protection, who told me this story. And I'm totally going to mangle this story, so if they're here, this is just now the myth I've created, not necessarily what he told me. My memory's not that great, right? But so in this pseudo-history I've created, the one partner during the drought, right, we're not technically in the drought anymore, even though the major environmental problems that caused that are still just haven't gone away just because it rained. But technically, you know, reservoirs are filling up and stuff. Anyway, during the drought, they have this leaky faucet, right? And if you've been reading the little leaflets from the city or whatever, like, fix all your leaky faucets, numero uno, right? You know, and so this person is, you guys know, if you can't fix it right away, you do the dishpan, and then you put that on your trees and your vegetables outside, right? Okay, my grandma taught me that one. And then, you know, there's this conversation in the household about, like, let's get a plumber over here, let's get this faucet fixed. Sounds pretty reasonable, right? Then another member of the household, though, says, like, well, what about these internal resources that you're using, like fretting about this and worrying about this and carrying that out, and then the monetary resources of hiring a plumber, couldn't we give that to the Sierra Club or somebody who's like making real change? Couldn't we do something real with these resources to make, you know, significant change in the environment? Okay, this is my myth, because that's how, if I wanted to start a fight, that's how it is. Shouldn't we be doing something real? Shouldn't we be making a significant change? Right? So do you get, this is one of these two right answers, either or decisions. And I want to make a request, because I know we're all really smart. Don't go yet to the solution that's bubbling up in your mind, but, oh, you could both be right. No, don't go there yet. Right? Because it's really easy when you're the third party, right? But when you're in one of these who's right games, it's really hard to be able to source that. That's actually a source of job security for people like me. Because you need that third outside party opinion sometimes. But I want you to feel it. Have you ever been in a who's right battle like this, right? Oh, well, you could do that, or you could make real change in the world. Oh, my. Oh, well, yeah, you could go for that grandiose vision, or you could start where you are. Oh, yeah. And these can get really interesting little battles. So the thing comes up, though, that these are not only happening with our housemates or spouses or cousins or somebody who visited for Thanksgiving or something. Oh, why are you taking that dishpan outside? Why don't you just blah, 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 right? They come up in our inner process of making these priorities when we're trying to make change. Have you had one of these kind of two right decisions that, you know, so the one I was thinking about myself, I have a policy of buying mostly organic food. Right? I occasionally slip on like cheat night, or if they're local and like I know their farm, but they just didn't want to go through the major industrial certification expensive process, and I'm like, okay, it's local CSA with your own goats, please sell me this non-organic food, right? But in general, as a political statement, right, we can throw out, oh, there's still pesticides. No, as a political statement, I want all the Costcos in the world to say, people like organic food. We better carry more and make it affordable. So I buy organic food, right? This is my political action. But I found this kind of like outlet grocery store. They sell overstock stuff, and they actually have quite a bit of organic stuff. I'm not going to tell you what the store is, because then you're going to go and buy all of my cheap organic food. You can't do that. But like the Mary's Concoctions, Wheaties, the gluten-free people know them, and they're like $6 a box. I got it for $3 a box. Wow. How much they used to cost before they were popular. Oh my God. Anyway, so I started going to a discount store and I realized like I was saving like $50 or $60 a week on groceries, right? And so it started to make me think like that's 200 bucks a month which could be going toward an all-electric car. If I just went to Safeway and like bought regular basmati rice, you know, in the little plastic packages or something like that. And so which one is more sound? My participating in the diesel industrial prison economic pharmacological industry by driving in my car but getting organic food? Or should I save that money and divest myself from the Saudi Arabian oil crisis insurgency, Al-Qaeda? Which one's the best right choice? And it's like, oh, geez, I don't know. And I can't take the Highway 17 bus because that thing costs $7 each way and doesn't go here. and if it rains, well, I can't get over here anyway when it rains. So have you had this kind of choice that you have to do? Man, those choices are a bummer. Please, just so I know, Nello, would you agree those choices are a bummer? Right? It's kind of a bummer. So if you come up with a third option, please tell me afterward at the coffee hour, like, well, here's $10,000 on a Nissan Leaf. Buy all the organic groceries. That would be a good option. I think I want the Chevy one, that one you guys.
Smart.
Yeah, because the Leaf doesn't go very far.
The Volt.
That's the one. I mean, that's what would be. Okay, different talk. If you're going to give me one, yeah, please. But I was kind of waiting for the cheaper one because, again, political statement with the middle class accessibility. So it's hard. And we have to make these decisions all day long. It may not seem like it, right? It doesn't seem like we're walking around, or maybe to you it does, but it doesn't necessarily seem like we're walking around making these ethical choices, one up, one down, like which one's right, all day long. But in fact, for those of us who said, yes, I have that save the world thing bubbling in the back of my mind, on a sub rosa kind of level, that we're doing that all day long. And it's another little browser open, or a little window open on your browser. Believe me, I had Windows Vista once. Those things consume a lot of energy, right? So the processor doesn't work very fast. And how does this manifest? It manifests in feelings like anxiety, fatigue, irritability, hopelessness, overwhelm. And one of these reasons is we're walking around and we're like, okay, which one should I do? How do I change the world? So we need to have some system. I think if we're going to be effective people in the world with our Save the World campaign, we need to have some prioritization, like algorithm or something. But there's a problem with that. And this is where the existential dread comes in, my favorite part. This guy says, don't let the existential dread set in. I'll show you more of him later. So, here's the real problem. The thing that we don't squarely face most of the day, but which is always going on, which is, there are no right answers. Right? I gave a whole sermon on this the other day, so I was trying not to repeat myself, but I was so into it that I put a lot of it in. There are no strategies that work 100% of the time outside of a laboratory, let's say, right? If you can control enough conditions, you go, oh yes, this generally almost always reacts in this way, you know, in this particular sterile condition. But have you seen any sterile conditions in the world, right? Ain't no such thing as sterile conditions. So there's a whole theory of this they call complexity theory. Have you ever heard of complexity theory? This is chaos math applied to sociology, right? And so what chaos math is known for is the butterfly effect, right? Little butterfly in Brazil flaps its wings, hurricane hits Florida, right? Because they say I just lost all the math words and trying to have my empathy circuits online. They still don't function at the same time. But you know, it's a system that's like, you know, basic standard causation. That we're not doing away with, you know, normal old billiard balls, but there's so many darn billiard balls that you're never gonna be able to track all the causes. So these little extra causes have these multiplicatory effects, these exponential effects. And so, yeah, butterfly wings, but you have no idea what's going to happen on the other end, right? So when we make a change in the world, like, you know, who knew how many factors for Martin Luther King Jr. to make the change that he made in the world? Like, how much had to be in there? What perfect blend of charisma and depression and oppression and familial support and community support and lack of community support? Like what exactly was that recipe? And if we try to recreate that, there are whole terrible sci-fi stories about, like, we try to create the perfect human in the laboratory, and it always goes terribly wrong, probably because they're sci-fi stories, and that will get better readership. But it's speaking to this fact that we never quite know what the ramifications of our actions are going to be. Right? So we can take some action that looks really beautiful for us, and if we're honest with ourselves, our mind should say, oh yes, 85% of the people who try this get a good result. But what if I'm one of the 15%? 90% of societies who have gone for this type of system of democracy have had this great result. But then there's these two countries who something really horrible happened to. Right? So with all of our decisions, we're facing this horrible existential crisis if we're honest with ourselves. Can anybody think of, outside of a laboratory, a 100% effective decision, strategy, tactic? 100% effective. No, they just don't exist. Everything, you know, you can get up into the 90s with some stuff. That's pretty cool. But we can't get one of those 100s. And so, bubbling in the back of our mind, we've got this project, and then we've got this, okay, how do I prioritize my right choices? And then even underneath that, we've got this, oh man, even my best darn effort might not do anything, right? Like today we have this activism 101, right? I have no idea how that's going to turn out. It could be pretty cool. Like, I put a flyer up at Fiddle's Coffee, right? Like, that could bring all the coffee drinking intelligentsia of Los Gatos. Or somebody might have seen that and be like, yeah, I'm going to go disrupt that thing. And it could be awful. Like, who knows? I feel like this guy is something. I don't know. Does anybody else feel like this guy? A little bit, right? So I wanted to get to this because we can get, like, there are great books on how to set your priorities and, like, how to build a tickler file that dings you on your phone or your eye thing or whatever, you know, and that's all cool, but none of that really addresses this issue. Like, underneath all of this is deep instability. Wow. So I want to show you the rest of this comic because I really like it. This guy knows how to prioritize his life. This is the title of this is How to Adult. Okay? So shop for a new tie. Make macaroni. Do cardio. Don't let the existential dread set in. Don't let it set in. Vacuum the rug. And I think adulting kind of feels like this sometimes. Like we just have to push that back and then sort of muscle on, right? Which the stuff's not gonna just sit there and wait for me to figure out my philosophical crisis, right? It still needs to get done. Real people are being hurt while I work out my metaphysical debates. So that's kind of interesting. So I think this one's really important because if we get the notion of this existential dread, it actually starts to undo my entire list of five, right? Because if we had something certain, right, we would know why it feels so stressful, right? Because, you know, if you have this one, this is what the religions in the world, why a lot of religions, you know, are very practical and actually very healing for the brain. It doesn't matter how fundamentalist or not, all of the religions that people strongly believe in have these, like, antidepressive, anti-anxiety effects. Because if you really believe it, You know the one true thing in life. Right? Oh, I don't know about this, I don't know about this, but I do know Jesus. And that's enough. I can just start from there. I don't know about this, I don't know about this, but I do know that the seven principles of Unitarian Universalism are true, and I can start from there. Right? But if we don't have something like that, if we're either ignoring that existential dread, or maybe we got okay with it, or, you know, me and Nietzsche were just kind of hanging, you know, like, things are still pretty stressful because it's a very uncertain world, right? If we were able to take care of that, it wouldn't matter that we're not able to do it all, because we would take the one effective strategy that we know, and we would do that, and then we would do the next effective strategy. Right? Like, we could extrapolate to these next degrees and just start where we are. We know exactly how this is going to turn out, but we don't know exactly how it's going to turn out. It's the complexity theory again. So much to do, but we can just start where we are because we know we've got this one next step that we can take. So if we don't manage this existential dread, it starts to feel like, has anyone ever procrastinated? None of us.
I was going to, but I didn't.
Well, you've heard of someone who's procrastinated. He's got a brother. So you can imagine how it might feel. You know, and you know, procrastination is the most illogical thing, right? The mind says, like, I've got this really important thing to do. It's going to take a lot of resources, a lot of time. I should probably watch that show. I saw an advertisement for it, and I think that's the answer. You know, and then we get to the end, and it's always that much more stressful. But it's also stressful while you're watching the show. Like the real procrastinators know, right? While you're scrolling the Facebook or watching the thing or whatever, taking the walk, it's not a fully enjoyable walk because your mind is like, oh yeah, and then when you get home, you really should get to work. And the other part of the mind's like, think of five things that you can do to get out of that. But you should, but I'm bad. But you know, and so the mind, again, it's running all of this stressful energy all the time. I think this is actually true with the unresolved issue of existential dread. We've got this issue in the back of our minds that, you know, if you think about it, like, we all kind of know that that's true, that, like, we're living in this radically unstable world. And yet, I don't know about you, but I didn't get taught anything about this in home ec in junior high. Like, now, here's how to carry on, even though the world is radically unstable, and you can't be certain of any of your actions. Many of them are going to be morally ambiguous. You're going to be wrong probably at least 50% of the time, and you're going to offend a lot of people through your best efforts. And then they should say that all and then give you like steps 1 through 5 to go on anyway. But they don't. I had to go out and read Nietzsche and Carlos Castaneda to try to figure it out on my own. Now they might give people vouchers for that. I don't take Carlos Castaneda in school, but maybe you can do it at home. Anyway. Clear his throat meaningfully. Okay. Sorry, sidetrack there. So I think we got to face it. We got to come down to that unresolved problem back there that just hasn't, it's just been waiting in the wings, consuming energy in our little brain computers. So how are we going to do it? I wrote a whole first draft of this sermon. Occasionally I do this. Fortunately for me, it doesn't happen a lot, but occasionally I write a whole first draft, which was, this time it was like 3 pages long, and I had to like really process some stuff myself. And then that got thrown out. But in it, I was, you know, there were like some life hacks and some little tools, oh, prioritization, and oh, that's cool. And then, gross. Because I thought, like, let's not have a managerial business meeting here today. Many of us have been to that meeting. Oh, here's how to increase outputs by 50%. And blah, gross. I mean, cool, like, we can talk about that later. But I wanted to do something much more meta. This term, I think the kids still say this. And I'm like, let's get a little more meta about it. Okay. Okay. Krista's got a shaking elbow. Yeah, okay, thank you. We teach each other about some kind of stuff sometimes, so it's power of the community. I wanted to get a little more meta. And I was like, what if there was, you know, well, this thing that ministers like to do, what if there was one strategy that would just, was like a meta strategy for all of these prioritization needs? That would be wicked cool, right? Just bam, fixed it. It doesn't, I don't know if it's going to work out that way, nothing is certain, but I'm going to try. Okay, this guy is the cutest image of a snail that I could find. And why is the snail up there? Not because of some like tortoise and the hare thing. Well, if you're going to prioritize, take it slow. That wouldn't be a meta strategy, right? That would just be one of those little small scale ones, right? So now he's up there because I looked up the words of the principle I'm going to give you, and this thing about a snail came up, this little viral screenshot of something. And so in this chat room somewhere on the internet, somebody asks, oh, what does a snail even do? Maybe this is a deep question you've pondered before. What does a snail even do? I mean, eats my garden, but also feeds my chickens. So, but what does a snail even do? And so somebody responded, it's best. So this little snail wants to teach you to do your best. The meta principle that I want to share with you comes from this body of work called the Four Agreements. So some people have heard that there's a book by Don Miguel Ruiz. It purports to be ancient Toltec wisdom. I don't know if it is or not, but many cognitive psychologists will weigh in and say it's at least wisdom, whether it's Toltec or not. So we're going to take agreement number four. Always do your best. Okay? So, always do your best is pretty cool in terms of all of this other stuff that we talked about. Just cutting through. For me, this just cuts through all of this stuff. Okay, number one, it cuts through because I mentioned in a previous sermon something along the lines of your brain is like a search engine. Right? It looks for what you tell it to look for. I mean, we have a certain degree of creativity. But that's a whole theory of mind thing, and that's complex too. But to a degree, you know, your brain, when you say, brain, Siri, please tell me the best way to get to such and such, the brain starts with blah, 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 blah. Results tabulated. Happy to be of service, right? Your brain is this little kind of like search robot, like Watson or something. That's the one who beat the guys on Jeopardy. In a situation where the faucet's leaking, should I take the dishpan out multiple times a day and then call the plumber as soon as possible and set aside some of our household repair funds for that? Or, brain, should I give this money to the Sierra Club, specify for waterways preservation? Brain, which one is the right answer? And the brain goes, tabulating right answer. Tabulating right, you know, and then a week later, brain, tabulating right answer. Because there isn't a right answer. Right, the brain will talk, well, on this side, you could do this. Did you guys see Fiddler on the Roof long ago? Right? I always remember, well, on the one hand, you could take the dishpan out and it would be good for your plants.
Yeah.
On the other hand, you could donate it. You know, and it's an infinite cycle of other hands. You're like Avalokiteshvara, the thousand-armed Buddhist. Maybe that's what he's supposed to symbolize. You know, there's always another other hand, right? But if you ask your brain, what's my best in this situation? It's a different question. It's a really different question. And this is a question that your brain, while it's kind of like a robot, it's also like a soul-heart bot, too. When we ask, what are my deepest values? What are my core strengths? What do I have in a unique way to offer this situation? That information is actually sitting there right under the surface. Also a problem with my home ec class in junior high. Nobody ever said, hey man, here's the five-step protocol about how to access your deepest values and what your gift might be to the world. Right? They just said, Here are the careers that are likely to make the most money. Here's a questionnaire you can fill out to figure out which one of those you might be. You're going to need this much to pay off the student loan debt that you get in so that we can insert you in as a cog in the vast machine that we've created for the god of industrialism. Or whatever your experience was. I always wanted somebody to say, like, here's how you can scrape off the accretions that form on a human heart just by virtue of living in a hard world and find the beautiful, shining virtues that exist under there that are waiting to come out like a warrior and change the society for the better. And so the trick is ask your brain. Brain, what's my best? And we come back to this Unitarian Universalist principle, numero uno. And this is the one everyone can recite, so please, if you know it, but Unitarian Universalist principle number one, the inherent worth and dignity of every person or being. So if you do your best, it's not the thing of like, okay, well, which decision, blah, 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 blah. It's which decision is most going to shine out the inherent worth and dignity that I am. And it's an interesting take on this. Right? So, for sake of time, I could talk about that forever, but for sake of time, we're going to go on. So it acknowledges the fact that there aren't any 100% answers. We're not trying to like skirt around that and be like, okay, well, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm going to try this because it might work. We're going to say, this is the best thing that I can do. But it also, the cool thing is that it doesn't allow for any laziness or sloppiness, right? Because to do your best, you have to find, well, is there a solution that works 80% of the time versus one that works 60% of the time, right? I'm bringing my best self forward. There's no room for like, everything's existential and nothing quite works. You get an excuse to finally be the hero of your life that you always wanted to be, even in a world that's radically uncertain and unstable. What else do you get to do? Being your best, always do your best, means that you're not expecting yourself to do better than your best. I don't know about you, but I've seen a few Nike commercials in my day, and we live in a give 200% society. If you've worked in the corporate world, if you tried to be a mom or a partner or a dad, you'll know that every American's duty is to take the right supplements so that you can give 200%. And if you can't give 200%, we've got a shoe that'll help you do it, or we've got an automated desktop Alexa or something that'll help you do it, and then you'll be able to give more than you are, because what you are is not enough. If we tap into this inherent worth and dignity, we can find out our best actually is good enough. And you might realize, for some of us, we have to get adrenal fatigue before we realize this, that our best is actually all we have to give. Right? Try to give 200% and you'll spend a few years giving 50%. The thing always balances itself out. But when we take this in, I'm going to always do my best, we start to find, it's that same as, well, hey, what are my virtues, what are my strengths, what are my qualities? We find this way that we can show up in any moment. And we show up with a sense of fullness and life. In positive psychology research, they call this a state of flow. On this graph, the bottom line is your skill level, and the top, the side, this guy, is, one's an X and one's a Y, I can never remember which one, is how challenging the situation is. So they say to enter into a flow state, you need a situation that is highly challenging, but you also need the skills to meet it. And this induces a particular state in your brain and body. Have you ever had the experience when falling in love or working on this totally radical project where you're creating all of this nifty stuff that's going to change your company or your world or your family, or writing a song or something like that, where you just worked for 16 hours straight, and then you got this expression on your face, it's like kind of like cherubic, like beatific, and then you just lay down and immediately sleep the sleep of the righteous. And you wake up and you're like, man, we're doing something in the world. Wow. And when you're in that project, are you thinking about how troubling it is that there are these 8 steps to come in the future? No, the challenge is actually too high to think about the 8 steps in the future, right? You're not thinking, oh, how did I get there? No, you're in a flow state, which means all of your energies are focused right in that moment. Have you felt it? When you fell in love? When you wrote that song? When you went to the march? When you made that extra $1 million? Whatever it was that put you there, that junction of skill and challenge that put you straight there in the present moment. This is this feeling of bringing our best. Okay, now compare that to my home ec class in junior high. Right? We're going to kind of make it through. What would the world be like if it were full of people who knew their worth and were willing to bring it out and were willing to find the way to take challenges and make that a generator of joy and value in our own hearts? What might our world look like if we were walking around in this state of flow, not overwhelmed by how much there is to do, but assured that right now I have something that I can do? The rest of the priority making all falls into line when we get this one true thing. I myself have found religion. I have access to that anti-anxiety thing in my brain because I believe in the power of the goodness of the human heart. So if we make that a priority, if we take our intrinsic goodness as a solid ground, we can go forward and do very good work in this radically unstable world. If you want something more practical, talk amongst yourselves and or come to our Activism 101 class shortly after the service. And speaking of after the service, let's sing our final hymn together.
That was awesome.